Da, 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 da. So thank you all for joining us for the Tech Fair keynote speaker. I'm pleased to introduce Ruston Hurley. He has been a Japanese language teacher, principal of an online high school, teacher trainer, educational technology researcher, and school reform consultant. He's the executive director of nextvista.org, a free educational video library, and runs the Merit Program at the Krauss Center for Innovation at Biddle College in Los Altos, California. Ruston trains teachers at schools and conferences around the country on affordable technology, the power of multimedia, and the professional perspectives and experiences of teachers at all levels. I'm very excited to have him. I think when we were planning his visit here in January, you were already booked up for 7 speaking events, so please join me in welcoming Ruston.
I want to make sure nobody's sitting in the first two rows. Good. That'll help in some fashion. Well, thank you very much for coming. I have loads of fun stuff to share. If you're like, no, I came in here to be very bored, then you're so totally in the wrong place. It is absolutely my design to make sure that we all have a load of fun. How many of you have fun learning every day? All right, just making sure. Some of you are like, I'm lying. Okay, no, that's all right. Sorry, we're going to get there. So what I'm talking about today has a lot to do with where we've been and I think where we are. We had kind of a cool pre-session on kind of where we might be going, which is anybody's guess. But I think that there are certain things about our experiences as teachers that are worth bringing into focus. And that will be a lot of the frame for what I talk about today. Okay, so my name is Ruston. I am a high school teacher of Japanese language. I am on leave in order to go around the country and train teachers to use technology and this kind of thing. I have also taught at the college level Japanese and also video production and other multimedia pieces. And I spent 1 year teaching one class at a junior high school. I'll talk more about that later. Because I think half of my story has come from that 1 year of 7th and 8th graders. I am a program director at Foothill up in the Bay Area, and I run a nonprofit, and I'll tell you a little more about that as well. Sometimes I think of it as a very nonprofit, but you know, still, the idea is to help people out. Okay, if you've ever been to one of those sessions where people keep throwing out URLs and you're trying to write them down and it kind of gets to be a hassle as you go, I don't like those either. This one link, all right, so this one link will take you to everything I mentioned and a lot more. So on this page, there are loads and loads and loads of free tools and resources. So feel free to go there, to poke around, to take a look at some of the things that I bring up and talk about, or to write me and say, hey, could you add this to it?
Yeah,
happy to do so. And I don't know if any of you are regularly use Twitter, but if you are tweeting now or anything like that, I am at RushtonH. So feel free to put anything out there like, hey, I just heard about this wonderful tool, or this guy's awful, or whatever it is you want to put in there. Okay, so some questions for the group. Which category do you fall into here? So this is the excitement about the tech. Figuring one of these has got to be you, right? Okay. So taking a look, is anybody that's in the A category, right? A? No A's, excellent. All right, we can make fun of them. All right, B, who's in the, if you're feeling pretty good? Ooh, C. All right, D. All right, and I see some of you like, it's against my religion to raise my hand. Fair enough, it's okay. It won't keep you out of heaven. By the way, we're all going to heaven Saturday, is that right? Or isn't Saturday the end of, never mind. Okay, moving on, matter of fact, if I insulted anybody with that comment, I apologize. All right, so how long have you taught? How long have you taught? Curious to know, all right. How many of you are in A? Like you're in your first 5 years of teaching? Yeah, all right. B, 6 to 15. Okay, chunk it. 16 to 25, the C group. Whoa, we got some better in the group. 26 to 35 in D. All right, and then anybody in the E categories? Like D does not capture the thought. All right, excellent. Not only is that cool, it's cool that you have taught so long and that you're here today for this. I think that's really wonderful. Thank you for coming today. All right, anybody just kind of understand what I'm talking about with the eight tracks? Who remembers the eight tracks? Yeah, that was a day. Okay. Now this is actually a much more serious pedagogical question than it may appear at first. How often in your classes do students go, wow, right? So if we were to use that as a measure of engagement at some level, might or might not be a good way to figure it out. But how often do people say, wow, okay. So I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand on that, because that might not be the best way. But it is something to shoot for. I mean, if what we do is to present content in front of these students in such a way that it gets them past their kind of weird social barriers that they put up around themselves, and they just stop and they say, whoa, then something good is happening in the classroom. Okay, so characterize your department for a minute. Take a look. All right. How many of you would say that your department is kind of an A department right here? I mean, they're just really, really into this stuff. Nobody. Okay. I want to ask how many of you are in technology-focused departments. What about B? All right. Okay, one of you. All right. What about C? C is an interesting one, right? You know, this is actually, it's not something necessarily to critique. I think it's part of the process for teachers to learn to stop and say, okay, how do I do what I've done before, but do it in a way that's more compelling? Before they get to that point where what happens is much more active for the learners. And then, of course, the D and E. Anybody in the department where you're like, man, that's my department, D, E, nobody. Okay. How about this one? I kind of asked you before, but let's break it down a bit. How many of you are in the daily category? How many of you in A, have fun, daily, all right? Often, how many of you are B? Okay, a lot of B's. C, occasional with people. All right, fair enough. All right, right. D, not sure what I'm talking about. All right. And then E. Nobody. Good. Okay. All right. Well, let's shift gears a bit. I'm not really a much of a PowerPoint fan. I mean, it's kind of useful for getting certain things out of the way. But what I want to do, for the most part, is try to get us in a mode where we're thinking about how different possibilities for our classrooms can not only enhance the learning experiences of the students, but enhance the personal experiences of those of us who teach, right? So it's not just about the kids, right? And I say kids, of course. You know, your kids may be, you know, averaging 42 years old, but when a student is having a great time in a classroom learning something, that's great. When a teacher is having a great time teaching something, that tends to set up an environment that allows the kids, the students, to learn all the better. I'm gonna play an audio file for you, because I wanna work us into certain kinds of technologies piece by piece. And this piece that I'm gonna play for you is a piece that I recorded when I was at a conference in Montreal, Canada, last summer. I was there for the Rotary International annual convention. Any of you in Rotary or another service organization, Kiwanis or Serapis? Right. Excellent. And I was there to present about what technology can do for a service organization. And so I was talking about things like getting the stories of the people who have dedicated themselves to communities and things like this, but also just sharing stories. So I'm gonna share this one with you. It's about 90 seconds long. And when I put the volume up, it's much more effective. Hold on a minute. Okay.
I joined the San Antonio Downtown Club in Texas in 2004. And in that first year that I was in the club, we had the pleasure of having a former Rotary International president come and speak to us. Well, he told a story that I will never forget. He told about having visited a small African village where a year before some team of Rotarians, or connected to Rotary in some fashion, had visited in order to put in a well. It seems that before the well had gone in order to get water, women from the village had walked down 2 miles to a polluted river to fill jugs with polluted water to bring back to the families in that village. So there he is, telling the village that he's proud that Rotary has been able to help them in some fashion. And afterwards, a woman came up to him and said something, and the interpreter took it in and paused and turned to him to tell him this. She says that she'll never forget the day the well came to the village, because that was the day the children stopped dying.
So I play that for a couple of reasons. One is to convey the power of the story, right? I can't tell you that story right now. You might say, what do you mean you can't tell it? You recorded your voice, so surely you can tell us the story. No, I can't tell you the story. I get choked up at the end every time. Every time, right? Without fail, it strikes me kind of interesting. I'm like, oh, should be able to have one. Anyway, I can't. So having done a few edits to make sure that I can get it right is something very helpful to me. But of course, one of the things that we do often is that we think, okay, you know, when I tell a story, I really want this to be powerful to the students. Well, it's powerful to the students if they're there and if they're paying attention, right? But if a student couldn't make it that day, or they want to share it with somebody else and have a discussion, maybe the person wasn't in the classroom, the person isn't in the class. And to have something simple available online that people could then use in some fashion can be very helpful. I quite think that one of the things that hasn't changed about education is that we need to share stories, right? There is this need that we have to say the kinds of things that will allow somebody to really stop and really listen and really to think. I don't know about you, but I have a lot of trouble paying attention in church. or if you go to church. And I can be sitting there, and it's just all I can do to focus. But once the preacher says, oh, there was this man who, as soon as there's a story, I'm paying attention, right? It just, I'm there. I don't know why that's the case, but it is. And so if it's true that stories are the powerful tool, it's always been that way at some level, then how can we incorporate them meaningfully to give our students better experiences and to make what we do in the class all the more engaging for ourselves? You know, I think that particular story about the well is also one where we stop and we sometimes realize, you know, okay, we wanted to put in a well, we wanted to help the village. But, you know, you hear the response of the old woman, and it occurs to you, we're doing much more good than we knew. Often in class, we're doing much more good than we knew, right? We see the expressions on the faces, they may or may not be changing, you know, in the room, but what we say matters. Well, for me, there's a story related to my teaching that one junior high class, all right, that I think kind of brings this across as well. So how I got into teaching a 7th and 8th grade class. One summer, I went down to the district office for some other purpose. I saw the person who was going to be the principal of the new K-8 school in our district. And I said, hey, you know, I understand you guys are going to have a video production program at Calajon, the name of the school. She said, yeah. I said, well, that's fantastic. I'd like to meet the teacher, maybe talk about some project possibilities. She said, yeah, we don't actually have the teacher yet. It was an uncomfortable silence. I was thinking in my head, we're only 3 weeks from the start of school, at which point I couldn't help myself and said, wow, we're only 3 weeks from the start of school. She said, yeah, you've taught some video production, right? And, you know, I was like, you know, and she said, it's a class of 7th and 8th graders. Do you think you'd be interested in it? And there was that moment of weakness where I was like, well, I like teaching 9th graders. How different can 7th and 8th graders really be? Neediest group of human beings I ever met in my life they were, but still. There was so much that I learned from them as we went along. There was this one kid, Christina, who would come in the first 6 weeks of school. I mean, she had this remarkably consistent entry to the classroom, kind of the first 6 weeks of school. She would walk in this way, you know, and just kind of, it's almost fangs, you know. Hey, Christina, how are you doing? I hope your day gets better. You know, and walk on. She'd sit down. Well, about 6 weeks into class, I got to a point where I was going to teach him how to use a program called Photo Story, where you take images and you create videos using images, record your voice behind them, this kind of thing. In order to do this, I needed to bring in some images to show him. So I brought in images of my daughters. My daughters are Gordita, Flaca, and Chiquita, right? They're cats. And if you're thinking, Gordita, that's a big cat. Oh, this is a wide cat. A circumferentially challenged feline this would be. At any rate, but these are beautiful cats, right? So I'm showing them how this program works, and I'm showing them pictures of the cats, and here's what you do, and you do this, and this, and blah, 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 blah. Okay, give it a shot. Go, go, go. So kids go do it. Up walks Christina. Here's the look on her face. Mr. Hurley. I'm thinking, whoa, where'd the face go, right? Mr. Hurley. Yeah, Christina, what you got? We have cats too. Oh. Suddenly I was her favorite teacher. You know? I mean, it's clear why. I would have been a decent human being. I have cats. I mean, it's obvious, right? But there it was. Every day she's walking into class. Hey, Mr. Hurley. The story for me there is, you never know what will connect you to a student. That student could be 12, 18, 50. But they walk into your room, ready to learn something. And you present something to them. And if there's something within that presentation that connects you to the student, suddenly things change. It happens at every level. It's necessary, right? It hasn't changed that stories are important to us. What has changed are the many ways we can explore those stories with them, yeah? I'm going to show you another video. I'm going to video the living daylights out of you guys over the next 90 minutes or so, just get ready. But this video, what you need to know about it is that it was done by a kid. It was done by a teenager. All right, and he made this video not because he was being paid to make the video. He made the video not because he was getting a grade for making the video. He was part of some summer group. It was just a community online that was doing a video stuff together. And the idea was to develop your skills. The particular activity for this was make a video about an organization that is important to you. So make a video about something, about an organization that's important to you. That was his entire motivation for doing it. He was working as part of a group. Here we go.
Thank you. to dream, to achieve, become.
Responses that way. But as a teacher, there's also kind of this haunting thought. What if the kid who made that video is in my class and I don't know it? What if we're teaching students who are willing to bring skills related to digital media to what we do in the classroom and we don't give them an avenue for doing it? I am all for a kid learning to write well. All for it. My mother is a professor of literature and composition at Southern Arkansas University. I grew up under the grammatical gun. I'm all for good writing. But kids have all kinds of different ways that they can express how they understand things. Often when we think about teaching and using digital media, what holds us back is we think, but I don't know how to make a video, or something like that. That doesn't mean squat. You can assign a video to your students. What? You gotta be kidding. I can't assign that. I don't know how to. They'll figure it out. If you're like, I don't know. Remember, what counts is the content. Whether it's writing, a video, what counts is the content. If you're asking them to explain their understanding of something, you will know from watching the video whether they do or don't. And if you don't know from watching it, you can't tell, then they didn't effectively convey their mastery of the content. Low grade, no matter how polished it may be. I tend to give students an out. I say things like, we're going to be doing a video project. If you would prefer, you may present a poster to the class. And in 11 years of doing digital video projects with kids, how many posters have I had presented to my classes?
None.
Why? I think it's a very simple reason, actually. Video is cool and posters are not. Right? But kids of all ages want to experience something cool in their learning, right? They want to do something that makes the other people in the room turn and look at them and go, wow, that was great. And when what we do as teachers is require things of students where the only audience is us, right? They kind of go from wanting it to be good to wanting it to just be good enough. How many of you have developed a twitch with the kid coming up saying, is this good enough? You know, what we want is for them to take pride in their work. We want them to write things and to create things and understand things and share ideas such that they would stop and they would say, I'm proud of this. I worked hard. I'm proud. And that's where we want to get them. Well, when the audience is expanding and we have something like video projects where they would all see what's going on in class, that's when things begin to change. So, if we think again, what's changed, what hasn't? Our ability to tell stories has changed profoundly. The need to do so hasn't changed at all. Show you another video.
Three balls and a strike to Captain.
And I'm going to turn the points up. This video is short. It's a sports one. See what you think.
Brent Johnson, one out, top of the seventh inning, Fresno 2, Tacoma 1, Santos in a jam, Johnson his first year at AAA, from the city deal, that's one out of here, he's got a left field line, toward the corner, and this ball is going to be.
Oh, it's fun! It's on Jake Wall.
That's the ball girl, Jake Wall in left field, can't believe it, and look, she shows him up, she just sort of tosses him the ball, says, take that, Jake, I don't see you making the effort, Alfonso the catcher, he can't believe it, let's look at that replay, oh my, what an amazing play, and And now look at her sitting there saying, no big deal, like that.
What do you think? That's a fun video, yeah. That got shared with me, and I know I said, I was like, wow, well, that's really cool, that's great. I shared it with my mailing list. I send a note monthly to about 6,000 teachers around the world. And people write back, said, that's a fantastic video. One guy wrote back and said, you know that's not real. And I'm like, what? You gotta be kidding me. All right, and he like sent me a link, you know, and turns out that video was a Gatorade commercial that never ran. And I was appalled. I'm like, what the? Partly because I was so wanting it to be real, you know. You watch a video like that, and you see the girl go, right? And you want it. You want that to be real. And so part of me was offended. I'm like, oh, man, they totally got me. I'm supposed to know something about digital media, right? I'm totally sucked in. Never bothered to check. But part of me was like, you know, maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe what matters about that video is what we want. What we want out of the possibilities for people who maybe have not been seen as those who can do such things. Those people walk into our classrooms every day, don't they? The video itself tells us a little bit about being critical, right? We have to be critical of the media that we are swimming in all the time. I was presenting to a group of teachers up in San Francisco a while back, and I was showing them how to use the program Audacity. How many of you have heard of Audacity? Right. Several of you have. The rest of you, this is a free program. It's free for, it's available for the Mac, it's available for Windows, it's available for Linux, it's just kind of whatever you like. And this is what it looks like. And at first glance, it's kind of intimidating. You're like, oh, there's negative numbers and everything, or whatever, right? But, look over here, look at this part. This is the part that lets you know you're in familiar territory. We were talking about the 8-tracks. Remember the cassette players? You guys remember this? I don't know if you're my age or right around then. You know, you remember being on the band bus, you know, like, you know, just going to the next town or something. You had your, you know, cassette, whoosh, comes up. You put in your, you know, Led Zeppelin or Journey or is anybody else with me on this at all? Anyway, there are a few people out there. So anyway, so yeah, we got record, we got play, stop, pause. I mean, it's stuff we've seen before. Well, this one teacher said, okay, I use that. I show my third graders how to use that program. I'm like, wow, that's really cool. What are you doing with your third graders? She said, I'll show you. Here's what she does. I am not guilty. All right. Here we go. I am not guilty. So she shows them that. And then she says, see, take a look. I am guilty. And then she turns to her third graders and said, hey kids, if somebody recorded you saying something and they wanted to make it sound like you were saying something different, they could, couldn't they? The kids are like, yeah, wow, that's not right. I am in awe of a third grade teacher helping kids begin to understand those issues, right? Beginning to stop and to say, you know, we can craft something quite special using these. And kids get excited about this. They do. I was in Chicago a while back, and a teacher was saying, you know, what we really need is we were wanting to do interviews of leprechauns. I'm like, pardon? She said, yeah, could we do that? Could we somehow make that happen? Probably, let's see what we can do. Well, hello, Mr. Leprechaun. Welcome to West Los Angeles College. It's a pleasure to have you here. Oh, it's such a pleasure to be here. It's been way too long since I've been in this part of California. So then you grab some of it. You go to effect. Change pitch. Bring that bad boy up a bit. Say okay. Go back to the beginning and play. Well, hello, Mr. Leprechaun. Welcome to West Los Angeles College. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Oh, it's such a pleasure to be here. It's been way too long since I've been in this part of California.
Now, I mean, this is kind of fun, right? I mean, that's not something you point to and say, oh, wait, that's research that will change, you know, the face of cancer research. No, I mean, that's not what that is. But it's engaging. For young people, I mean, you know, they do stuff like this and they're like, wow. imagine if what we want is we want our students at age 16, 18, 20, 30 to craft a message, right? To be able to summarize something they've read meaningfully. To be able to ask important questions related to the content we teach them. We ask them to write summaries. Fine. But again, the audience is down to one person. What if you have them do it via something like this? They begin to really care about it sounding right. The audience is expanded. Maybe it's just a little more fun for them to do. But as long as the content is good. The issue is always, is the content good, right? I would say that our need to help kids at every age be critical of the media that they see on TV, the media that they see online, the media that they are just constantly inundated with, that hasn't changed. But our ability to fake a story and our ability to get them to think about those possibilities and to work with them actively and engaging them, that's changed a great deal. Part of what we experience. And we're talking about students finding ways to tell what they are learning. I'll come back to video and show you something here. My nonprofit, which is an online library of videos by and for teachers and students everywhere, free to use, free to contribute to, and free to download. Thank you very much. It's my 20-second elevator speech. And we do these contests where we invite students to make videos explaining something in some time frame. In this particular case, it was 60 seconds or less. And just see what you can do. And then we take the finalists, we put them in front of an audience with clickers, and they choose the winner. Well, here's the winner from a fall contest that we did up in Napa.
Hi there, my name is Keegan Duranian, and I'll be introducing you to the main functions of a neuron. A neuron is an electrically excitable cell that makes and transmits information by electrical and chemical signaling. Dendrites are branch-like structures which primarily receive chemical messages from other neurons. This middle part, which looks like an egg yolk, is called the cell body, also known as the stroma, which contains a nucleus. The myelin sheath is a pink series of fatty cells that covers the axon to work like insulation. The axon is a solid black cable-like line which has the purpose of transmitting an electrochemical signal to other neurons. After watching this video, I hope you'll understand the major functions of a neuron.
I won't do all the credits because he used a lot of pictures in that video, right? And they kind of go on a while. Fun video. Now, I've had people watch that video and stop and say, yeah, but I didn't get to the end of it really understanding the functions of a neuron. Well, I too am not one of those people who, when they read something once, get it right away. The question is, are students motivated to go back and watch it again? Right? The ability that we have to use different tools to get students thinking about things repeatedly is something I think very important for our getting them to reach a level where they feel they've mastered something. And so I look at something like this, and you know, there's a kind of interesting things going on in this video, right? So for example, take a look at this. In this piece of this video, you know, he's got what he's saying at the bottom. Okay, first of all, kudos to him for having subtitles. I mean, that's good to help anybody. I mean, certainly people with hearing difficulties, but being able to see what's going on at the same time helps reinforce the message as well. But take a look. Here are the subtitles. They're white, right? Here, they're white. Here, they're black. Why? Because the picture behind the subtitles is life, in this case. That's actually showing a level of sophistication about the images that's really quite impressive. When we did this in the audience, it was at the Fall Q contest up in Napa. We had several hundred people in the audience. And they voted total runaway for this video. Why? Because the video was engaging, because it was engaging on a lot of levels, because it was impressive on a lot of levels. because people really did feel that this is something that could help a student learn something. How often do we feel that the fundamental concepts that either students should know when they walk into our classrooms or need to learn as we teach them what we teach them just don't seem to be sticking? And what might it mean to what we do if we have them making short videos explaining important concepts as they go? And in a shameless plug for my own nonprofit, you've got a place where they could go. So let's work together on that. Now, there are more examples of what happens on a personal level with video. And I want to show you actually the winner of a contest we did where the finalists were all shown in January at Macworld. It was called the Made on a Mac 60-second contest. And this winner was actually a notably younger group of students. But I think it tells something interesting about the use of videos as well. So here we go.
Everything, this pencil, this ball, even you, are made from atoms. Atoms are the building blocks of all matter. All atoms have a nucleus. It is the center of the atom. Inside the nucleus, there are usually two types of particles. One type of particle is called the proton. It carries a positive electrical charge. The other kind of particle found in the nucleus is called a neutron. Neutrons are neutral, meaning they don't have either positive or negative charge. Outside of the nucleus is where you find the third type of particle, the electron. Electrons have a negative electrical charge, and they move around inside the nucleus when entering a cloud. There are at least 90 types of atoms. The number of protons, neutrons, and electrons an atom has determined whether the matter is an apple,
or this one just edged out a piece on prepositions. There they are. The Room 7 Mad Scientists. It isn't a rule that science videos win, I mean, but it just happens to be because those two did. Here's the thing. When the audience in San Francisco voted on the winner of the contest, and the voter on this one, all they knew was that it was a good video. I think I had also told them that it was from a school in Webster Groves, Missouri, which is, I think, part of St. Louis. What they didn't know was that this school is a school for kids with special needs. When the kids found out that their video was a finalist, they were so excited. And when they found out they'd won, oh man. Why shouldn't their learning experiences be celebrated widely, right? The things that they pick up in classes here, wherever they go, if they have a great insight about the different things that they're learning, if they've got some clever way of conveying it so that it helps others, why shouldn't the audience be expanded? Why shouldn't it be worldwide? How valuable is this to students who have limited English? Because they can listen to it again. What is this word? Stop, pause. They can get right to it. Rather than trying to explain where they think you were when they used a word that they didn't quite catch. These tools are incredibly powerful. I don't know that I'm telling you anything you don't know. But I think that when we see these examples, we get closer and closer to, what do we need to do? What do we need to do to make it happen in our courses? So, when we look at stuff like this, you know, I think we are reminded of how the need to vary our presentation of content has not changed, right? One size fits all with presentations has never worked, never. Some students do great. They come in, they pay loads of attention if the explanation isn't particularly coherent, they go and they fill in the gaps themselves, they do fine. But there's a lot of students that don't. And it could be that finding ways to get it in front of them such that It might appeal to more this style or this style or this style. It helps everybody. I mean, how good would it be to get to the end of the semester and figure out that the students really had, by and large, learned almost everything you taught, right? And if we get really good at finding ways to get more and more angles to them on how we present stuff, all the better. I think what's changed is how they see themselves in this process. You think about those students at Miriam School in Missouri. Being a part of that, knowing that the work they did for you becomes something that helps other people, is very different than just knowing what their grade was. All right. While talking about the site for a minute, this is my nonprofit site, Next Vista for Learning. It's at nextvista.org, N-E-X-T, vista.org. There are a lot of things we're trying to do to encourage more videos. I was involved in a grant that I want to tell you a little bit about. That was rude. One more time. And let me see. I do that. And I come back. And I will tell you more about this later. Because I can't. I just can't do it at the moment. On the site, there are a collection of careers videos. 5 minutes or less, right? Where what's happened is a student or a teacher has highlighted somebody's work. And it's essentially a video that answers four questions. What's your job title? What does a typical day look like? What kind of education or training does it take to get the position? And what do you love about your work? If you ask the average 13-year-old, you know, how many jobs are out there, they're like, oh, this is what my mom does, what my dad does. There's a teacher, there's an NBA player, there's the custodian, there's the president of the United States, there's a fireman, there's a police officer, did I get them all? Right? And what they need to know is that there's all kinds of wonderful opportunities out there. I mean, you know, kids' engagement in school, and then consequently their understanding of the value of their experiences in college, a lot of it comes down to having some sense of the possible path, right? But we've got almost 100 videos with things like oceanographic scientist, gourmet butcher, right? ROV pilot, you know, things like this that get students stopping and say, oh, that looks like a lot of fun. It is. You got to know your math. It changes the way they think about a lot of this stuff, and sometimes changes the way they see their own possibilities. I'm going to show you just the first little bit of the oceanographic science video. Make that point.
Hi, my name is May Engels. I'm an assistant scientist on board the Robert T. Siemens, which is a sailing school vessel. We are a study abroad program for high school and college students, and we study oceanography and nautical science. We have a land portion of this program where the students get introduced to oceanography and nautical science, and then they get their practical experience at sea. And when they come sailing with us for 4 to 6 weeks. So my background is I studied biology in college, and then in grad school I studied geology. Now that may not seem like the right things to study in order to study oceanography, but the beautiful thing about the ocean is it doesn't really matter what science you study, it all pertains to the ocean. So for example, if you are interested in physics,
it's a good video, it keeps going. She's a scientist, right? There's a lot of 9, 10, 12-year-old girls that need to know that she's a scientist. See a video like that, and they're like, the blonde woman wearing sunglasses is a scientist? You know, blink, blink, blink. You can read it on their foreheads. Don't you have to be old and a white coat and a long beard? You know, this kind of thing. No. And you can see it in their eyes. I want to be like her. Yeah. If what we do exploring career possibilities allows students to begin saying, I want to be like that. Because we get so many different things in front of them. New role models. Regular folks. They don't tend to get this stuff on the evening news. Right? What's the evening news? The evening news is all about, you know, hatred and scandal and disaster and terror and a little sports and weather. right? What we need are stories of people that do interesting things, that don't tax their rather limited attention span. You know, that kind of thing. And so we see what we can get. I want everybody to think their thoughts. There we go. Okay, now, well, what I've got here, right, with these videos, is a bunch that have been put together as a result, largely, of an SB70 grant. How many of you are involved in SB70 grants or something, anyway? No? Getting what we do related to grants out there so that people can really understand the benefits of what we've been involved with, getting videos online that teach something, I mean, your grant could be about anything. After we take a break, which happens in about 30 minutes or so, we'll have some time for discussion. And if you're involved in a grant and you want some suggestions, I will be happy to just kind of give them to you. Okay, well, here are some things we could do. I mean, I'd be happy to work with you as a partner. Shameless plug number two. Okay. On to search and collaboration. How many of you have seen this before? Okay, this is an are you paying attention question, of course. This is one of those pages that we all work with. But there's all kinds of things that happen with Google tools that you might not know. I mean, I could spend several minutes showing you wild and funky shortcuts that you'd be like, you gotta be kidding, does that? So just I'll show you one later. If you want to see more, just let me know and I'll show them. What is the zip code here? 90230. So weather 90230. Whoop, there you go. Right. And you can do all kinds of things. Like, there's all kinds of things you can do from that front page that are really, really efficient, helpful. All kinds of things. The people at Google are finding all sorts of interesting ways to take what they do and make it all the more useful to what we do. I'm about to say a sentence that I'm guessing you've never heard before. I'm going to show you a few things related to a spreadsheet that's going to be very exciting. Okay. Anybody like, no, no spreadsheets, I enjoy them every day. Okay. This is a standard spreadsheet, but this is a Google Docs spreadsheet. How many of you use Google Docs? All right. A lot of you do, right? Google Docs is a very cool system. If you kind of like, I hear everybody else talking about it, I'm going to give you the 30-second description. Microsoft Office, Google Docs, right? Word, Docs. Excel, spreadsheets. PowerPoint, presentations. Google has these three tools. Microsoft Office has these three tools. But they're different enough, right? For example, if you want lots and lots of bells and whistles, Microsoft Office is a much better choice. But Google Docs comes at a much better price point.
That's free.
Right? And so, that's not where it stops. There's all of this kind of collaboration that's possible with it. It taps into things that you might not have known it does. Things like that. Got me making sure that we've got a connection here. So I'm going to show you something real quick here. So I'm going to highlight 1 through 5. Okay, everybody can see that just fine, right? It was kind of hard to see the blue around it, but it's there. And then I'm going to go to where this little blue square has appeared and bring it down. And boom, it gives me 6 through 10. And if that was really exciting to you, your bar is low. Right? Every spreadsheet does that. It looks for patterns in the things that it's got there, and if it sees a pattern, it will repeat it. So if you've got, you know, 3, 6, 9, 12, you do the same thing, it'll give you 15, 18, 21, 24, 7. Alright? Fair enough. It doesn't tend to do a very good job on text. Matter of fact, it doesn't tend to attempt it. It might see, if you have January, February, March, it might know to put in April, May, June, July, etc. Right? But by and large, if you just have regular text, so you've got something like rocks, grass, ocean, you know, whatever. And you do exactly the same thing. What a spreadsheet will normally do is just repeat the text, right? So it repeats them, because often that's what somebody would want. You know, we got these four things, we want to keep bringing them down. Okay, fine. But let me show you this. Can you see what I'm highlighting now? And by the way, what I'm about to show you could be considered by some as shocking. Okay, so we've got Egypt, South Africa, Sudan, Uganda, and Kenya. I'm going to bring this down. I'm going to fill down like before, but this time I'm going to depress the control key at the same time. many of you are in like a whoa, what just happened mode right now? This is intense, right? Essentially, I highlighted five terms, and by pressing the control key, option on a Mac, by pressing the control key, I was essentially telling Google, give me five more of that set. Because if it takes five terms, and it understands them to be five separate terms, which it does, they're in five cells, and it goes out online and finds lists on web pages that include these five terms, which it can, and we tell it we want more, why shouldn't it grab other elements of the lists that are out there? But this is interesting on other fronts as well. Take a look. So over here, I'll put a cherry, apple, banana. And so if I do the same thing, what am I going to get? More fruit. All right, so I go down. Here we go. Now, some of you may not be phased. Others may be looking at that next to last one saying, that is not a fruit. Others are like, I saw the next to last one, and chocolate is a fruit in my world, and I make sure to get five helpings each and every day. But when we first selected cherry, apple, and banana, that's more than one set, isn't it? It's a set of fruits, but it's also a set of flavors, or pie flavors, or ice cream flavors, or whatever. And highlighting a set of terms and saying, students, what will we see more of? You only have to do this a time or two before they start thinking quite laterally. In terms of computational thinking, this is incredibly important. Okay, those items are a part of what sets, what other sets. And thinking about things in that way can be very, very powerful. Students, we're just thinking about what's possible, right? What we really need now, what we really need now to show how important this is would be horns. And I'll bet, if we just really want it, it'll happen. What we need would be horns. Excellent. All right. If you're like, that was a little silly. Yeah, but we had fun. Okay, I see that you got capitals going on there as well. Yeah, I do. And you might say, okay, well, so you typed those capitals in. I said, no, I didn't. So someone else typed them in. No. Wait. So I'm going to scroll down here. Here's the formula, Google lookup, B9 and C3. B9 is Tanzania, C3 is capital, Dar es Salaam is the capital of Tanzania. You might say, but what do they? It's Google. If Google looks at the term capital and the term Tanzania and can find loads of web pages that say the capital of Tanzania is, why should it be able to tell us? What if the information's wrong? Then it would give us something wrong, which is not helpful. But on the other hand, you can compare it against lots and lots of web pages. This is a different world we live in, yeah? Being able to stop and to say, okay, how am I going to search for information? How am I going to bring it together in some way that's useful? Things have changed, right? We've always had the need to kind of look at evolving tools and to say, well, how are we going to organize this? What's changed is the ability we have to do interesting things with it. How many of you know about Google Squared? Really? All right, here we go. Google.com/squared. It's a labs thing. That always means that it should be quite funky and God knows what we'll get. But here we go. My favorite example here is US presidents. Done it before. So I put one term in one search field and I click square it. It thinks about it and gives us something like this. And knowing what you know from what I showed you in that spreadsheet a minute ago, you know what's happening, right? It's going out and it's looking for things. If it looks at a term and it can find sets related to that term, and then it does secondary searches on the items in the set and finds certain things that are consistent in the secondary searches, why not organize it for us? The tools are evolving. The need to find and organize information hasn't changed. The tools for doing it? Cool, right? Now, this won't do just anything. I mean, it has to be something that you kind of legitimately look up. If you did a search on courage, you know, it's not going to give you a different kind of video. But still, how interesting is it that we've got possibilities for this? How many of you look for ways to save yourself time in your teaching? All right. I see loads of hands and a lot of. There may not be any bigger barrier for us. Yeah, time, I need more time, right? But it turns out that in Google Docs, let's get these out of the way. You guys know about forms? How many of you use Google Forms? All right, several of you do. Those of you who don't, I'm just in Docs. I say create new, and I go to form. And it gives me this. And so, who in this room? Actually, how many of you are working with some kind of grant right now? You're working with some kind of grant. Okay. All right, a lot of you are. How many of you have more than 40 students to work with this term? How many of you have more than 80? More than 120? You're getting right down there on the secondary level at this point, right? Sometimes you need information quickly from students. Sometimes you need information quickly from the people you're working with on a grant. If you are in charge of a department, or you are part of the team that runs a department, and you need information quickly. I mean, how have we always done it? You send out a thing, you ask people to check something, it comes back in, some poor schmo has to sit down and collect the entire thing, and it's just as much fun as it sounds. But why not something like this, where we say, okay, let's see. What would be, somebody give me something that you teach, all right? So just call out something that you teach, a subject.
Art history,
okay, great. And so, and have you been teaching an art history course this term?
Yeah.
Okay, so what would you say are like two or three of the main concepts you've taught? Or it could be particular artists.
The main concept is tell me what you see.
Okay, and are there particular genres of art or artists that you use to convey that to the students?
Well, are we checking what they know, so you're thinking of a question that I could find out whether they...
I've kind of got the question. I just need a category. I need something that...
Perspective,
okay. So perspective is a term that the students really need to have a feel for. What does that mean, right? And you're not going to be able to do much squat in the class if they really don't know what to do with that term. There are probably some other terms as well. I'm just going to say scale. And we'll say on a 1 to 9, where 1 is, huh? And 9 is, got it. And I say done. Well, I can create this program, right, or this survey very easily. I can make it pretty by going to theme and choosing something. Let's say artistically, we like that one, urban landscape. Fine. All right. Do not enter. Cool. All right. Apply. You're like, hey, where is it? It's there. It's right here. And then maybe for this, we just want to check, you know, what their name is, right? Your name. Done. And so it takes all of a minute and a half to put something like this together, right? I mean, it's really, really quick that you can create this. And I say save. It's good. Now, if I go to the published form, here's what it looks like. And I tell my students, okay, on a 1 to 9, where 1 is, huh, and 9 is, I got it. How comfortable are you with the concept of perspective? Student says, oh, I feel good about this one, you know. Phil, all right, submit. Now this is simply a way, I mean, what I'm showing you right now is simply a way of gauging where they feel they are. But sometimes when we're teaching a series of concepts, we don't quite know where they are with them, right? So we choose to do certain kinds of presentations to see if they got it, right? We give them tests, they take the tests, they come back in, we grade them, we hand them back, and we find that they really got it, or wow, only a third of these students got it, or whatever we find. But if you can check right away, right, so I'm going to go back to, it's not there, here's my art history quick check. It takes me to a spreadsheet with the data. Everyone in class with a device connected to the internet could go and take that in seconds, and you would immediately have their results. If the average for their understanding, what they feel their understanding is of the term perspective, is a 7 or an 8 or a 9, you nailed it. Great, keep going. Fine. If it's a 2 or a 3 or a 4, you need to spend more time with it. Right? Being efficient with our time is this incredibly important piece of what it means to teach well. And knowing where they are, or at least where they think they are. I mean, this could as easily be anonymous. You wouldn't have to have Phil proclaiming his knowledge and perspective, you know, this way. You're also getting a timestamp. I mean, there's lots of things you can do with this. But getting information back quickly, that's something quite different for us. How many of you are intrigued by that? You're like, yeah, I think that's something I might try to use. Okay. When we get into discussion time, if you want to talk about it more, we can. Do you have any questions about it right away? Yeah.
Can you try another subject here?
Sure.
Plate tectonics. This is geography.
Yeah.
Plate tectonics. I'd like to see what we can do.
Okay. In the in this or in that search?
No, no,
in the search. Thing. Sure. Now, you're talking about the square thing? I don't know. I'm not optimistic because I don't know how many different kinds of plate tectonics would come up. However, let's take a look. One of the things I learned from the junior high kids that year I taught them was this. Well, here's what happened first. I'd put something in front of them and I'd say, hey, give this a shot, see what you think. They'd be like, wow, what do you do here? What happens here? What if you click here? You know, I was like, what? You know, watching them go. Because, you know, as adults, we tend to be in this mode. Train me. You know, this kind of thing, right? You know, and so we hold back. You know, why? Oh, I don't want to break the computer. I don't want to break the internet. You're not going to break the internet, right? But the kids, they're the ones that get it right, right? So coming up with something like this is like, well, will plate tectonics work? We could theorize about whether it will or won't. I started to do it, I mean, out of habit. But here's the way to find out. Let's see what happens. It came up with some stuff. There's an add columns thing over here. Meaning, volcanoes, animation, geography, movement, design. And is it a perfect thing for us? It might not be a perfect organization of ideas, but might it move in the direction of generating more ideas? Ah, right.
Click volcanoes, what happens?
If I click volcanoes, it adds a new one, it searches on all the terms related to, you know, this and plate tectonics and that. And where it has multiple values, I say choose from two, and it says raising and renewing the earth, weathering and erosion. It says low confidence because maybe it can't find enough different sites where that's the issue. But the process itself is valuable. Good suggestion, thank you. Okay, let me keep going on this here. And any of the things that I'm covering, if you want me to cover them in more detail, you know, a little later after we take a short break, I'm happy to do it. Happy to do so. Okay, now, one of the things I should mention, by the way, is that I know a lot about Google tools because I am a Google certified teacher. Ooh, dig me, right? And that means I've been through a thing called the Google Teacher Academy. These happen every so often. They're happening now at a rate of about 2 a year. It's happened, I think there have been 10 or 11 of them. The last one was in Sydney, Australia. And they just recently announced the next one. The next one is going to be in Seattle in late July. And the application period is open through, I think, mid-June. But I have on my site, for for you guys. If you were here at the beginning, you'll know that there is a site, tinyurl.com/rh-malac11, right, which has on it some info, including this link to Google Certified Teacher. Click on that, it'll take you to an application page for it. There aren't enough tertiary teachers in the group. There are some, right? But just not enough apply. I rather think that if you are interested in the possibilities of technology, that's not the equivalent of being a technological guru, not at all. You're interested in the possibilities of technology. You're someone who tries things out. You have an audience, right? You keep a blog. You train people on regular occasions or something like that. And you are applying as a college professor. You may have a leg up when people apply. Give it a shot. Why should we bother doing so? Because you learn such fascinating stuff, and even better, you become a part of a group that is sharing ideas constantly. I get a digest email every day from the Google Certified Teacher list from around the world. Amazing ideas. I'm part of several lists. None of them come anywhere close to this one in terms of the quality of the information shared. Really dynamic teachers from all levels sharing ideas. Consider it. Okay. Next thing. The idea of sharing with each other brings us to another bit of the what's changed and what hasn't, right? One thing that hasn't changed is that as teachers, what we do is really quite isolated, right? We go into the classrooms where we teach our thing, you know, the students interact with us about it. Often we just don't get a lot of time with our colleagues. Occasionally, you know, department meetings, conferences, whatever, but just not generally a lot. And that often deprives us of understanding something very important. Another story for you. So as a second year teacher at a high school in San Jose, I was on several committees because that's what you do to young teachers. You say, why don't you join this committee? And you're afraid to say no. I mean, that's where it goes. So I was doing some committee work, and it was my prep period, and I walked over to a friend's classroom to talk to him about something or to get some info from him. Well, this friend is a guy who teaches world history. And he's not a desks teacher, he's a tables teacher. It's kind of more like this, you know, where there's a table and two students sitting at each table, something. So that's kind of how we run this classroom. Fine. But I walk in, and on that particular day, all of the tables are on their sides on the floor. And the students are sitting on the floor next to the tables, writing furiously. I walk in, you know, I'm like, what's up? Right? He said, oh, you see, we're studying World War I. They're writing letters home from the trenches. I'm like, oh, that's so cool. That's just amazingly cool. And I'd have never known if I hadn't walked in there on the committee work. That's not to say the committees are a great thing. What I'm simply saying is that all kinds of cool things happen on our campuses every day. And we don't know. We're in kind of a mode as teachers. Don't brag about what you're doing in class. You know, I mean, because you can't say anything positive about your own class and have it be interpreted as anything but bragging, right? Well, that's a useless way of going about things. We should be sharing ideas. This worked great. This flopped completely. What do you think? How can we make it better? Who should we be asking? Our colleagues. Our students. All right, guys, we just did this activity. Did it work for you? Did it help you understand this material better? How could we make it better? What do you think? We need to be sharing those stories as educators of finding ways to do what we do better all the time. Makes it more fun for us. I kind of think that once we get into that mode, we're able to do something quite important. Breaking the isolation, I mean, the isolation, that hasn't changed, you know. What's changed is our ability to connect. Whether it's as a part of, you know, a Google teacher group or an online crowd that's interested in, you know, medieval underwater basket weaving, whatever it is, right? Something that allows us to stop and go, I have people I can connect with, share ideas with. talk about successes and failures. Make it better. You know, that is something that I think is really powerful, but one thing technology does, and I'm probably preaching to the choir at some level here. I mean, if you show up at a tech fair, you're probably not afraid of technology. But if you think about our colleagues, we have colleagues who are afraid of technology. They think, you know, I've been teaching for however long they've been teaching, and everything's getting so complicated. Let me show you a video real quick, because that's the way I roll. Let's see. They walk in every day, and you can tell it in their faces, right? And if you do something really well, if your class goes well, if your activity makes them go, whoa, you know, right? That's good stuff. And what has changed? Our ability to get students to see things in new ways. Why do I show a lot of videos? Am I just into video? What is the number one adjective that students use to describe schooling at all levels? Maybe not in elementary. Boring.
Boring.
Oh yeah. Boring. And I don't think it's because that school is necessarily boring. I think it's because it's predictable. No matter how good we are as teachers, as instructors, when we walk into the room and we do what we do, the students sit there and they kind of know what's coming. They may not know the exact content, but they know how it's going to be delivered. And that kind of moves them into a lower gear. There are so many ways now to put something in front of them that is unpredictable, which is, I think, equivalent to interesting. When we push play on a video, it could be anything. It could be someplace nearby. It could be far away. It could be off the planet. It could be the past. It could be the present. It could be some vision of the future. People they know, people they've never met. It may not bother to conform to the rules of physics. It could be anything. That's interesting. And it gives us the opportunity to see things about what we do and who we are, especially in how our students choose to react to what we present to them, that perhaps we never have before. One more video. This video, what you want to know, is it's a lip dub. A lip dub is like lip sync, but with lots and lots of people. And it was made by a group of students in a town in the state of Washington. Apparently there is a town called, I believe, Short Crest. And there are two high schools, two comprehensive high schools in Short Crest, Shoreline and Shorewood. The Shoreline kids made a lip dub to some popular song. And lots of them were involved, and it was a pretty good lip dub, and you're fine. But at the end, they made this critical error. They challenged the rival school to go one better. This is the rival school's video.
Thank you.
it completely. That was a video production one class.
That's why there are no cuts.
Right. There are no cuts at all. It is one pass through the entire school. What else is going on? It's backwards. Why do I show you a video like this? Right. Well, partly because something has changed. Cynicism seems to happen at younger and younger and younger ages, you know. And I hate the thought that as a comparatively privileged group of people in the world, we're generating a bunch of young cynics. And sometimes we think, oh, well, but you know, how much spirit do these kids really have? And then you watch something like this. It's not that there's no spirit there, right? It's whether we're choosing to find ways to encourage it. And I love a lot of things about this video, but the thing I love most, everybody seems to be involved, huh? Every group in that campus seems to be represented in that video. You know, at one point, you know, there's a guy working on something that looks like graffiti, and next to him are three guys doing Rubik's Cubes. Right? You see the cheerleaders in the step club, the guy with the guitars, I mean, you know, headbangers. You may have noticed when the swim team came through at some point. Right? I think it's so cool that they are finding the excitement that is a part of sharing who they are and how they feel about their school in that way. I believe if you do searches on LitDubs and colleges, you'll find plenty of good examples of it happening at the tertiary level as well, which I think is pretty cool. But the question keeps coming back to this. What do we do, right, to inspire our students? To inspire spirit, to inspire excitement, to inspire high-reward thinking, meaningful critique of media. What do we do to inspire a connection between them and us, such that they're actually excited to learn? And it turns out we've got all kinds of new ways to do it and have fun along the way. I do not believe it is our job to entertain children, however old those children may be. That's not our job as educators, to entertain. But if we, as teachers, as professors, as instructors, step in front of the room and we enjoy doing what we do, we have fun teaching those classes, the students will come along with us. I hope that as you look over this and you look at the different things that I've presented here, you'll find pieces of this that you'll say, you know, that's going to be useful to me. I also thank you for taking the time and coming to listen to me. You can get in touch with me. There's my email address. There's my little very nonprofit's website for saving the world from ignorance, one video at a time. Please. All right. You can find me on Twitter that way. Here is the website with loads and loads and loads of freebies for you. Go on and check it out and see what you think and explore it. And if you have any questions, contact me. Sometimes I'm kind of slow to reply. I get a bit of an avalanche of emails from time to time, most of the time. But I will reply eventually. And just let me know. Hey, you know, caught your presentation at West Los Angeles College. Got a question for you. I will get an answer to you. And so I hope that what we're talking about with digital media, with collaborative tools, with the excitement of building an audience and inspiration in our kids is something that will go well beyond the room today. Let's take a break. We've got chips back there. We've got water. We've got those little brownie bites that pack an enormous number of calories, but they are that good. So Get up and just kind of stretch a bit, you know, take a few minutes to do that, and then anybody who wants, stick around and we'll discuss some more. I'll show you some more stuff. Thank you very much.